This program deals with themes of an adult nature and is intended for a mature audience.
The very word secrecy is repugnant in a free and open society. And we are, as a people, inherently and historically opposed to secret societies, to secret oaths, and to secret proceedings.
Our differences worldwide would vanish if we were facing an alien threat from outside this world.
We must guard against the military-industrial complex.
Exopolitics, paranormal phenomena, and deep analysis of current world events. From somewhere in the desert, between Area 51 and Roswell, blasting across the planet, the Manticore Network proudly presents Veritas. Because the truth will set you free.
Headline edition, July 8, 1947. The Army Air Forces has announced that a flying disc has been found and is now in the possession of the Army.
I'm as mad as hell, and I'm not going to take this anymore!
The power they took from the people will return to the people. And so long as men die, liberty will never perish. Soldiers, don't fight for slavery, fight for liberty!
The only thing we have to fear is fear itself.
Sooner or later, though, you always have to wake up.
Be skeptical, but don't close your mind.
Greetings to everyone around the world, and a warm welcome to another edition of Veritas, alternative media for discerning minds. I'm your host, Mel Fabregas, and I sincerely thank you for joining me once again. And if this is your first time, make yourself at home. I want to thank all our members. As always, you are keeping Veritas alive. Tonight's special guest is John Lamb Lash, Metahistory and Gnosticism. This will be one of those shows that you will have to listen to many times. Truly mind-bending. John Lash will be with us shortly. To listen to the complete version of this and all our past and future shows, become a member. You'll receive instant access to all our shows. And remember, Veritas survives on your voluntary subscriptions only. Just head on over to our website, veritasshow.com, click on subscribe, and take Veritas with you. And the cold weather is already here. And you already hear the coughing and the sneezing. Don't be caught off guard and order your MMS directly from us, whether you live in the United States or abroad. And if you buy health supplements anywhere, you are paying too much. Why don't you take a look at our news source featured on our website and compare? You can buy as many products as you'd like. They have thousands and only pay $5.95 for your entire shipment. And you also get a 30-day return policy. Pure quality. Check them out. And I only have a few USB drives left with Season 1. Before I place another order, you get all of Season 1 shows, bonus chats, ebooks, and all the music of Season 1. Lots of bonuses. Go to the Veritas store link on our website and take a look at all the contents. And if you need to get in touch with me, go to our website and click on the contact button or join me on Facebook. I have two very important announcements to make on this Veritas second anniversary month. First, I would like to introduce a new amenity to Veritas members. A new chapter in this journey. Veritas TV. As you may know, Veritas has been and continues to be work in progress. Now that I feel comfortable with the audio side, I'm now immersing myself into the video production aspects. As I've always said from the beginning, I have no formal background in journalism, radio, or video production. Everything you have witnessed from day one has been nothing but a learning process. I hope you have learned as much as I have. In the past year, I have collected a few video interviews and short clips, and it's now time to share them with you. I have a few more videos that I will be uploading in the next few days. I also intend to start adding video interviews and lectures as they become available. So enjoy and check back periodically. I'm really excited for the beginning of this Veritas phase. Please excuse the technical errors you may more than likely see. It was either waiting a few more weeks of analysis paralysis or simply uploading them as is. I chose the latter. The feature video was filmed on November the 6th, 2010, and it includes a fascinating lecture by Dr. Claude Swanson, The Science of the Paranormal. This lecture was superb, and Dr. Swanson will be on Veritas very soon. So there you have it, Veritas TV, a new phase in the Veritas journey. Where is it? Go to the website and click on the TV link. And here's the second important announcement. I have decided to do a special show for the holidays. On December 24th, I will air a show without a guest. It will be just me answering your questions on the air. Many of you frequently ask me specifics about the show, about me, about the topics we discuss, future plans and ideas. That's when I decided to produce a special edition of Veritas called Inside Veritas. Your participation is requested. How? By submitting one question. Anything goes. The requirement is that you have to be an active Veritas member, and it has to be one question only. The deadline is December 19th, but I may stop much earlier if a limit of questions is reached, so don't wait too long. Furthermore, I will raffle a metal-cased 8GB USB drive containing Season 2 among those of you who submit a question. So what are you waiting for? Submit your questions soon. Here are the instructions. Go to our website, veritasshow.com, and click on the contact button. You will see a link to Inside Veritas with instructions. I want to make sure that those who don't have anywhere to go during Christmas Eve will not be alone that night. When you listen to Veritas, you are never alone. Thank you for your participation, and good luck in winning the USB drive. It's going to be a fun show. And the holidays are here, and if you're still thinking of what to give for the holidays, why not give the gift of truth? Give a Veritas subscription. You can buy 3, 6, and 9 months, or 1 or 2 years. Give something that may change people's lives, not something that may be put away in a drawer forever. Plus, you'll be supporting the show in the new year. Just go to the Veritas store and change someone's life. And one last thing. Today's CNN poll asks, do you think life exists on other planets? 85% of the respondents said, yes. What does that tell you? Perhaps the population won't react to the War of the Worlds scenario again. We can handle the truth and are ready for disclosure. John Lash unravels historical textual evidence, exposing the cover-up, conspiracy, and agenda behind the betrayal of humanity's spiritual heritage. Principles, he informs, deviated by a political system in the guise of religion, a religion modeled primarily from patriarchal domination, ignited by the delusional beliefs, intimidation, and the power of suffering, leaving in its wake a horrific legacy of conquest and conversion by violent force, suppression, and hypocrisy. Join me as we discuss the evidence that describes the source and motivation behind the tragic eradication of the mystery schools by these forces. If you want to continue believing, stop this audio now. If you want to know, don't go anywhere. John Lamb Lash is coming up next. This is Mel Fabregas, and you're listening to Veritas.
This is Zechariah Sitchin, and you are listening to a wonderful radio interview conducted by Mel.
John Lamb Lash has been called the true successor of Mershe Eliade and the rightful heir of Joseph Campbell. Unlike those two world-class academics, John is a self-educated freelance scholar who combines studies and experimental mysticism to teach directive mythology, that is, the application of myth to life, rather than its mere interpretation. He is a leading exponent of the power of myth to direct individual experience and drive historical events over the long term. An expert on sidereal mythology, naked-eyed astronomy, precession, and the world ages, he also teaches the critique of belief systems. On metahistory.org, he presents a radical revision of Gnosticism, with original commentaries on the Nag Hammadi codices. He also presents the only complete restoration by any scholar of the Sophianic myth of the pagan mysteries, the sacred story of Gaia Sophia, recounting the origin of the Earth and the human species from the galactic core. John Lash is the only scholar of comparative mythology so far known to have rewritten a classical myth, giving it a different outcome, Orpheus and Eurydice. His published works are The Seeker's Handbook, Twins and the Double, The Hero, Manhood and Power, Quest for the Zodiac, and Not in His Image. In John Lash's own words, he says, "I have only this to tell you about my enlightenment. It's yours." And directly from the southernmost point of continental Europe, Punta de Tarifa, Andalusia, southern Spain, I'm proud to introduce John Lamb Lash. Hello, Mr. Lash, and welcome to Veritas. How are you?
Well, thank you very much, Mel. I'm fine, and that's a wonderful introduction. I thank you very much for that, what you said.
It's my pleasure. May I call you John?
Yes, please do.
And first, let's define who you are, John. Honestly, it's been somewhat enigmatic to me, the subject of Gnosticism. I have to be honest. We spoke the other day, and it am somewhat new, and a lot of our listeners are probably new too. So I want to make sure I tell everybody that I got your latest book, Not in His Image. I cannot put it down, but I got it about a week ago, and I've only been able to absorb about one third. So I can only cover so much today, and there is so much to discuss that I'm offering you, John, more shows in the future to continue, because the amount of material that you cover is so vast, there's no way we can discuss today. Do you agree with that?
I agree, Mel, and I thank you very much for that opportunity. It's really necessary to proceed in that way because the subject of Gnosticism is so important, and it has taken an enormous amount of work in the last 65 years since these texts were discovered. It's taken an enormous amount of work by other scholars and by myself to restore and recover the essential message of Gnosticism. That's what we'll talk about this evening, because I firmly believe that the essential message of Gnosticism is the key ingredient for the planetary shift and for a sane and compassionate future for the human species. So it's a very, very big subject and certainly warrants taking it in several doses.
And tell us who John Lash is. We want to know of your background. What made you look into Gnosticism and all these areas that the mainstream media and mainstream academics don't even cover?
Well, I have a couple of factors in my character that would account for the course I've taken in life. Basically, I'm just a country boy from Maine. I grew up in a very beautiful coastal village in the state of Maine, a place called Friendship, Maine. It's a lobster fishing village. And I grew up in the pristine beauty of nature. And there were two factors in my life that directed me on the path that I've taken. The first one is that from an early age, I had a number of startling and really overpowering spiritual or supernatural experiences. And I don't think that I'm unique in that category. In fact, I tend to think that many, many people do have these experiences as well, and they have them when they're quite young. The trick is to stick with those experiences, to remain with them and to develop them and learn from them. And that's not so easy to do, because you might be a child of 8 or 9 and have some supernatural experience. You might have a lucid dream, such as I had, or you might have some encounter with an interdimensional being. You might have had a guide or messenger that showed you something, or a moment in nature when something divine was revealed to you. And then you go back to ordinary life, and there's no support for your experience, and your education, and your parents, and the people in the church, and the people in the town or city don't necessarily give you the recognition. So what I was able to do was to stick with those experiences that I had. And I've always had then, I would say, a very intimate relationship to the divine and the supernatural forces that are at the source of our life. The second factor just came out of my character. I mean, it's just a rebellious kid. I think all kids are. You know, I questioned everything. I did not like what people told me. I did not believe what they told me, especially about religion and God. The little town that I grew up in, a fishing village, was really a fundamentalist Christian community, and they laid it on me very heavy. So I got that whole program, accept Christ as your personal savior, the whole belief that the Old and New Testaments contain some kind of blueprint for human destiny, you know, that sort of idea. And I just did not buy it for a second. And again, I think I'm not so different from many other people who also reject this culturation and this religious and spiritual programming. But the problem is, you have to hold on to your rejection really hard, because they will try to knock it out of you, and they will try to make you conform. And so somehow I managed to have the strength to stick with my own experience, and that's what makes me a heretic. and heretic is the great word. You are a heretic as well.
Yes.
And heretic, you know, is a very beautiful word, Mel, because it just comes from the Greek verb, which means to choose, to have a choice. And you know, it's like I wrote in Not in His Image. Christianity, for instance, is a religion. It's a creed embraced by billions of people, but rarely chosen by anyone. Because you only have a choice when you have an option. And if you had an option to Christianity or Buddhism or Judaism, perhaps you choose the option. So heresy, and we're going to be talking about that tonight, because the Gnostics were heretics. Heresy is about having an option and keeping your option open. And this is very important in spiritual development, and not easy.
And I think it's very important also to define two words. I don't want to call this show Narcissism 101, but pretty close. Can you define metahistory and Gnosticism?
Sure. Metahistory is a word I invented when I was working with a group of other people around 2001, a nonprofit foundation who wanted me to do a website for them. I invented the term metahistory for the name of the website, which is metahistory.org. Metahistory simply is like metaphysics or metanoia. It means beyond history. So what does it mean to go beyond history? Well, what is history? You know, history is the story we are told about humanity. That, in the largest sense, is what history is. Now, if that story is true, then we have a true story to guide us. But if that story of history that we're told is full of lies, disinformation, errors, and things that are only present in the story in order to condition and control our minds, then when we become enslaved to a false agenda for the realization of our humanity. And so metahistory is to go beyond those conditioning scripts of history and to find a true story for our humanity and a true story for the planet. That's the purpose of that site.
And Gnosticism?
Well, Gnosticism is a word that is very problematic. You know, scholars got together in 1966, I think it was, at this famous conference called the Messina Conference. The highest, most respected Gnostic scholars in the world met in Italy to discuss how to define Gnosticism. And they met for like 3 days, and guess what? They couldn't come up with a definition.
Have you?
But I have come up with what I consider a workable definition. First of all, you need to know is that the Greek word gnosis means knowledge. That's all. So a Gnostic is somebody who knows, a knower. But the trick to the definition is what kind of knowledge? What kind of knowledge is Gnosticism? And I think the best definition for starting would be to say that Gnosticism is the knowledge of the true identity of humanity and our place in the cosmic order. That is true gnosis. If we know who humanity really is, where we came from, and what we are doing on this planet, and how our life on this planet belongs to a design of the cosmic order, then we have gnosis. We have knowledge of the divine basis of human reality.
And while we're at it, before we can start, another definition. Pagan. Define pagan.
Well, pagan simply means somebody who lives in the country and somebody who lives close to nature. That's the root definition. The historical definition is that pagans were the indigenous people of Europe prior to the rise of Christianity. A good, helpful comparison might be this. I use it in my book. Prior to the arrival of Europeans in America and North America and in Mexico and South America, many indigenous peoples lived there in different tribes. And they were pagans. Those were pagans. The Native Americans were pagans. The Aztec and the Maya, people who lived in close to nature and lived in a culture that was pre-Christian or non-Christian. Those are pagans.
And right now, paganism or pagan, it's almost a derogatory word. If you utter the word pagan...
Oh, it is a derogatory word.
Yeah.
Because it's been demonized. But that was a systematical program to demonize paganism. To say, for instance, the early Christian ideologues who were promoting the message of Christianity, the message of salvation and the Messiah, said about the pagan people of Europe, well, they go out into nature and they give offerings to trees and rocks, and they talk to the sky and the clouds as if they were alive. And they talk about the earth as if it was a goddess. And all of that is evil, because they are really worshiping demons. Nature is the source of demons. This is what the early Christians said in order to condemn and demonize the pagans. And even today, it's shocking how seemingly intelligent people will use the word pagan to mean Satanist or devil worshiper or someone involved with the demonic. It's entirely false. Entirely false.
And it's a foundation or basis for Gnosticism. The name Hypatia comes to mind. Who was
right.
Hypatia, and why is she so important to the Gnostics?
Well, my book begins with a dramatic account of the murder of Hypatia. And in the historical records written around 400 AD, there are 7 accounts of this murder. It was a very big event. It happened in 415. Hypatia was a woman who lived in Alexandria, and her father, Theon, was a teacher of mathematics and head of the Alexandrian library. And Hypatia was a pagan, that is to say, she was not a Christian. She did not believe in the Christian idea of love. That doesn't mean she didn't believe in love, make a very clear point about that. Pagans have their own concept of love, but it's not the Christian, Judeo-Christian concept of love. And she was a teacher and intellectual at the university school in Alexandria. And she taught science. And it is quite probable that she invented or played a role in the invention of the astrolabe, which was a very important piece of technology that was useful for sailors and allowed them to sail around the world and explore the world. So she was a woman of high intellectual attainment. Mm-hmm. And she was murdered by a Christian mob in 415 AD in Alexandria, murdered in the street as she was returning home from teaching at the university. Many historians say that the Dark Ages began with the death of Hypatia, with the murder of Hypatia, because from that point on, the program of intellectual genocide went into high gear. And with the rise of Christianity, every single document, every single library that the pagan intellectual world had established was destroyed. And the people who wrote the books were murdered or hounded into hiding. And so the Dark Ages began because the teachers and the intellectual and spiritual guides of the pagan world were liquidated. This is a true story. And this is a story that is rarely told from the viewpoint of the defeated. It's usually told from the viewpoint of the victors, who were Christian teachers and Christian ideologues and historians.
I think it's important, John. I usually don't like to read from a book, but I have to read just this small paragraph so that people mm-hmm. who are listening know what really happened here. Mm-hmm. Let me just read this. The violence of the mob escalated rapidly, and they're referring to the murder of Hypatia. Its intensity fed by the raucous shouts of Peter the Reader. He called Hypatia a vile heretic and a witch who beguiled people through her beauty and her teachings, which were nothing but the wiles of Satan. Hypatia protested and cried for help, but a stiff blow broke her jaw. In a matter of minutes, she was on her knees in a pool of her own blood, crushed under a flurry of blows and kicks. She was rapidly beaten to death. Not content merely to take her life, the mob pounded her naked body to a pulp and tore her limbs off her torso. The number of the attackers and the ferocity of their assault made it impossible for anyone witnessing the murder to intervene. And then, after they already killed her, wild-eyed with excitement, several members of the mob ran to the nearby harbor and scooped up the razor-sharp oyster shells to be found there in abundance. They returned and passed out shells, and Peter encouraged his henchmen to scrap every last morsel of flesh from Hypatia's bones. When the men were done, they took the scraped bones to a place called Sindron and burned them to ashes. Was that the end of the pagan world and Gnosticism?
That is the absolutely destruction of Gnosticism as far as the Hypatia being an example of a Gnostic. She was a Gnostic. And the symbol, this is actually a graphic description of a murder. Now, you know, there's a movie recently called Agora with Rachel Weisz, which is actually the life of Hypatia.
Is that right?
Now, I haven't seen that movie, but it's been around, Agora. And it may actually depict this murder in that movie. Mel, what is so vivid about this murder is not only the extent to which they went of finally scraping the flesh off her bones and burning the bones, but it's the symbolism of that. What they did to Hypatia, they also did to the tradition that she represented. They also did to the vision story of the Gnostics, their story, their myth about our planet, their knowledge about the origin of humanity, their practices of mysticism, of sacred sexuality, of higher education of the human species, their teachings of the great works of literature and art. All of that flowering of pagan culture was destroyed in the same way that Hypatia was destroyed. And that is why that murder and that scene is indelible can never get that out of your mind once you hear it. And the question that that scene raises is a really important one. Why did they have to do that? You know, I mean, we are told that the rise of Christianity in Europe, in the pagan world, was in one way a good thing because Christianity is a religion of love, isn't it? Well, I ask you this question. If Christianity is a religion of love, what is the mark of love? What is the signature of love? I would say that one of the signatures of love is coexistence. In other words, if I love and I have love in my heart, then I have the spirit to coexist with others. But when you look at the history of the rise of Christianity, they did not tolerate coexistence. And even more than that, they targeted this particular group of people called the Gnostics. The fact of history is that the Gnostics and what they knew had to be destroyed, liquidated, for Christianity to come to power. And no historian has ever answered the question of why that had to be so.
And was her murder the end of classical civilization in Mediterranean
Europe?
Totally.
Totally. Almost every historian you read who deals with the rise of Christianity and the end of classical pagan culture will say, 415 AD, murder of Hypatia, end of the classical world. Absolutely.
So it's the end of paganism and the dawn of the Dark Ages then?
The dawn of the Dark Ages, because Christianity, for the first 1,000 years, was so tyrannical and totalitarian that it would not allow people to have an option of any other story. So it destroyed the books, it destroyed all the literature, the countless numbers of scrolls and manuscripts written by these Gnostics and these teachers in what were called the mystery schools, and I want to get to what that term means in a moment. And the real question is, how could they have been so threatening? What was so threatening about what these people knew that it had to be eliminated to the point of scraping the flesh off the bones? What was it? We didn't know, and there was no way of knowing until December of 1945, when a precious fragment of that knowledge was found that had survived, because it was buried in jars in a cave in the desert.
And what came out of that?
What came out of that was a picture of the Gnostic view of the world, the Gnostic understanding of the story of the earth, of our planet. I call it their vision story, the vision story that they taught, the vision story that was the basis of their mysticism. And also, some insight into their practices, other things that they believed, the things that they taught. They were kind of like, they were spiritual teachers and trainers, the Gnostics. And finally, really, the answer came as to why they were so dangerous and why what they knew had to be eliminated. And that is that they had an argument against the Christian belief system. And this argument was so powerful that if it had been allowed to have a fair hearing, Christianity, the Judeo-Christian course of history as we know it, would never have ever happened.
And one discussion we seem to be having on this show, John, all the time, is mm-hmm. that of the divine feminine. The Gnostics mm-hmm. worship a goddess. Was it Sophia, the Gnostic fallen goddess?
That's right. They, at the center of their vision, I call it a vision story. The Gnostics had a vision story, and the center figure in this story was a goddess called Sophia. I call her Sophia.
Okay.
And you can call her Sophia if you like, but I call her Sophia because it rhymes with desire.
Uh-huh.
And she, and desire is a very important part of this story, because the reason why we are here, the human species on this planet, is because of the desire of the goddess to perform a great experiment with humanity. And they tell this story. It is one of the most beautiful myths. It is a totally unique myth I call it the fallen goddess scenario. And when you get a little further into my book, into the second third, you'll see that I have recapitulated and restored this vision story. I'm the only scholar of Gnosticism who's done this, who's completely restored the story. I haven't invented anything. I've just reconstructed it out of the fragments that were found in this Nag Hammadi discovery.
And the Gnostics risked their lives challenging the supremacy of the male creator. Why did men feel so threatened by women?
Well, that's a really good question. Let's just say that that's a really, really good question. Because the battle that happened at the time of Hypatia was definitely a battle between the sexes in a way. So I think I would try to answer your question a little bit indirectly by placing it in that context, back in that context. The Gnostics were part of a network or movement of pagans who had a relationship to the divinity of the earth. This is the key phrase that you have to register. Their goddess that was central to their practice, their movement, was not somewhere out in space. She was not merely a symbol of the divine feminine. She was not merely a projection of Mother Nature. She was the divine presence of this planet. And you used the word worship, Mel, which is a natural word to use, but not really accurate. They didn't really worship her. They interacted with her. They interacted with this divine presence. They encountered her in their practices, and they learned, they said that they learned everything they knew from her, from communication and interaction with this divine figure. Now, we're talking there about people who have a relationship to the divine feminine. And those people were a very great threat to another group of people who came in with the biblical idea of God, Judeo-Christian Islamic idea. In other words, God is male, is not on the planet, is somewhere out in another world, is invisible, and he lays down the rules of how we are to live. And we men, we prophets with beards, receive the rules of God. We are the intermediaries, and we are all men, and we are in control. And this whole system, this whole male control system, which is using religion as a tool of social control, was tremendously threatened by these people who were connected to the goddess. For a number of reasons, but first and foremost, because the people who were connected with the goddess pointed out that the system of what I call divine paternalism, the system of the belief in the off-planet father god, is insane. They came out and said so. They didn't just say, you know, they said, okay, we see what your belief system is. You think the earth was created in 7 days and that there is only a male creator God. He doesn't even have a wife or partner. He's there all by himself. And we're here to tell you that we have been in the practice of spiritual work and discipline for thousands of years. We belong to a very ancient tradition. And we want to warn you that this belief system is insane. And that was very, very upsetting to the people who got that message, you know? And they had to eliminate the Gnostics because the Gnostics had the ability, they had the cogency, the sobriety, the spiritual vision, and the courage to come out and say, your belief system is wrong and delusional, and it will do enormous harm to humanity.
And one aspect that caught my eye was that the Gnostics were inspired by a sacred theory of the earth. Let me read this part. Mm-hmm. Gnostics were accomplished mystics inspired by a sacred theory of the earth, but they were not religious in the conventional sense. That is, they did not impose a moral code doctrinal formulas and institutional authority.
That's right.
The Gnostic message had two components, a sacred vision of the earth and a radical critique of salvationist doctrines centered on the Judeo-Christian Messiah, especially the Redeemer complex. The Gnostic critique was brutally suppressed because it challenged the core beliefs of imperialist Roman religion, beliefs that have as much, if not more, political utility as they do spiritual veracity. What's your take on
totally,
that?
Totally, totally, yeah. Let me make it clear to the readers, because I don't want to be throwing around the word Christianity. You know, obviously, when you're talking to John Lash, you're going to be subjected to a certain amount of Christianity bashing. I want to make sure that people understand exactly how I bash Christianity. What I'm bashing is not the thought that we should love each other or help each other or be kind to each other, you know, which are supposed to be part of Christian ethics. As a matter of fact, those values are part of many other ethical systems, and Christianity certainly does not have a monopoly on love and kindness and generosity. No, what I am critiquing is the same thing that the Gnostics critiqued. I call it the Redeemer complex, and it has four components. It's a belief system. It's not an ethical system. The Gnostics did not criticize the ethics of the early Christians. For them, it was obvious. Of course, we all are going to be better off if we're kind to each other and help each other. Pagans believed in the natural goodness of human beings. So insofar as Christianity states the natural goodness, there's no conflict. What they critiqued was the four points of the Redeemer complex, which are: one, the world is created by a off-planet Father God, like an artifact, the way that a potter creates a pot. Second point, the off-planet Father God designates a chosen people to fulfill his will. Third point, the off-planet Father God sends a messiah or emissary to his chosen people to help them fulfill his plan. And fourth point, because none of this works out and humanity doesn't go along with the plan, the off-planet Father God at the end of time brings doomsday upon the world, and he inflicts an apocalypse of retribution, taking the chosen ones to heaven and condemning those who do not follow his orders to hell. This is the belief system. This is the core belief system of Christianity, Judaism, and Islam. It's packaged in different ways in those three religions, but it is the core belief system. And the Gnostics, like Hypatia, when they saw this belief system gaining credence in Rome, in Palestine, in Alexandria, in places around the Mediterranean, in the first and second and third century, they came out of the mystery schools where they were teachers, and they said, hey, hold on a minute, hold on. Let's have an open discussion about this new belief system in the Redeemer. And they pointed out really devastating things about this belief system. And for that, they were targeted for elimination.
So much for thou shalt not kill.
So much for thou shalt not kill. So much for let's have peaceful coexistence. If Christianity is such a wonderful thing, then why can't people just embrace it and accept it out of their own hearts and allow any other belief system to coexist alongside of it? And if it's so much better, well, there's no competition, is there? But there was very serious competition, my friend. And I'll tell you, this story has never been told in the way that I tell it. I'm telling one of the most important events of world history, the history of our species, from the point of view of the losers. And that's a story that's got to be told.
Because the winners, the history is written by the winners, of course. And we have
look
to dig
at where the winners are taking us.
Yes.
You know? Look at what's happening on the planet right now. There's a really lot of rumors cooking, as you know, on the internet, that we're heading for a very big doomsday scenario. You know that. And we know now that these scenarios are all faked and that religion is used as a pretext for war and to divide people and manipulate them. We know that now, don't we? We're waking up to that, aren't we? Well, I'll tell you, the Gnostics saw it coming. The Gnostics saw it 1,800 years ago. They saw it coming. And they knew that if humanity, if this belief system with these four points in it was imposed on humanity, it would do two things. First, it would function as a program of social enslavement. It's not really a religion. It's a program of psychosocial control. And the second thing they realized is that it would lead to terror and confusion and insanity. And that's pretty much where it's leading.
That's where we are, actually.
That's where we are. And so I show in my book that these Gnostics saw then what has, where we are going today. They saw it coming.
And incidentally, you keep using the word coexistence. I have something to say, by the way.
Yeah.
One of my favorite areas in Spain is where you are, Andalusia. I love Granada. There you had Christians, Jews, and Muslims living by side and practicing their respective religions in peace. Churches, synagogues, and mosques right next to each other.
That's right.
What changed that, John? Talk about living in peace.
Well, living in peace is only possible if those who embrace a belief system are not driven by that belief system to impose it on others and are not driven by that belief system to want to control what others do. You know, tolerance is the word that describes the pagan world. And even long after the pagan world was destroyed, there were pockets of tolerance, like you're talking about Granada. It was in Christian Europe or in Moorish-occupied Spain.
Right.
It was a small pocket of tolerance. But outside of that, there was enormous intolerance through the intolerance of Islam and the intolerance of Christianity. So peace is only possible. You know, religions have brought more war and destruction and division to this world, these Abrahamic religions, than any other factor in human experience. This should be obvious to anyone who looks at the historical record. You know, there's been more war and genocide and murder and holocausts, like the holocausts against pagans and witches that went on for centuries, since the message of the Prince of Peace has been broadcast upon the land. How can that be? There's something deeply insane and deeply schizophrenic going on with these Abrahamic religions, and the Gnostics were able to point it out. So I dedicate the first six chapters of my book to what I call describing the problem. I don't know if that's probably what you've read up until now, describing the problem of this Redeemer complex, this belief system, and how it came into existence. And then the rest of my book is actually dedicated to the solution to that problem, which is looking into what the Gnostics knew and what they taught as a choice for humanity of another kind of story, not just another belief system, because Gnosticism is not an alternative religion. It's an alternative to religion.
But let me go back, if I may, to that part of Granada. You know, many people think that the Moors, let's demonize the Moors for a second.
Right.
You know, when they came for 800 years and so on. But when you look at Granada, it was during the time of the Moors that the different religions and peoples were cohabitating next to each other. It was the Christians retook that area of the world that they started building churches on top of the mosques and on top of the synagogues and even the Alhambra Palace was Moorish, and they completely put a more Christian aspect of architecture on top of it.
That's right. And that's because, you may wonder how this could be. That's because these religions that are based on the Redeemer complex, that four-part formula, are not really religions at all. I mean, if you think religion is about spirituality and love, then they're not religions. They're social control systems. And that's all they are. And they're about conquest, programming, and control. And the Gnostics, who had a real, genuine spirituality of the earth, and of the divine feminine saw through this hoax, as some of us today are beginning to see through it, you know. Because, you know, you can throw out those four points that I mentioned, the off-planet Father God, the chosen people, the Messiah, and the day of revelation, the day of reckoning, of the judgment day. You can throw them out and still be a loving, generous, kind person who coexists with others and does good to your brothers and sisters, because they don't have anything to do with the ethics of living in a compassionate way. And that's what the Gnostics saw. They saw that that belief system was delusional and very, very harmful. So I concentrated in my book on the problem in the first six chapters, but I don't want to spend too much time on the problem, because the solution to the problem is so beautiful. And I was able to go back into the Gnostic materials and find what they taught, not what they believed, because they were teachers, what they taught and practiced. And that is such a vision story for us today, and such a healing story that I really believe can put humanity back on course, where these salvationist religions have taken us toward an endgame scenario that's very, right now, playing itself out.
And an interesting—
Does that make sense?
Absolutely, absolutely. And an interesting point in your book, Nodding His Image, you talk about how the Spanish conquistadores had been themselves abused, and they did the same with the natives in the New World. Genocide,
that's right,
and ecocide,
that's right,
once again. But, John, was greed the primary motive for European conquest of the New World?
I think that greed was the primary motive, yeah. I certainly look at what they did. They robbed those native cultures blind when they couldn't murder them. They robbed them blind. They took their land in Mexico and Central America and South America. They took enormous amount of gold and silver. You know, the richness of the Catholic Church today comes from the gold that was taken from the Maya and the Aztecs and the Incas, you know? So greed was definitely a factor, but what really drove the conquest of the New World was the, what I call the victim-perpetrator bond. The victim-perpetrator bond in pop psychology is called abuse bonding. And this is something that's quite well known. I'm sure some of the listeners have heard of it and may have even experienced it. It was generally discussed 20 or 30 years ago in the circles of recovery of John Bradshaw and people like that, talking about dysfunctional families. And one of the things that was observed was that in a dysfunctional family, say if there's an abusive father, say a classical situation that the father's an alcoholic and he abuses his wife or his children, the people who are abused form a bond with the abuser. This is a psychological reality, and they will not betray the abuser. It's called abuse bonding or victim-perpetrator bonding. And it's a very well-known phenomenon. It also occurs in hostage situations where it's called the Stockholm syndrome. That is, the people are taken hostage, they're abused, terrorized, and controlled by the people who take them hostage, and then they become bonded to those people, and they adopt the beliefs of the people who are victimizing them. This is a well-known syndrome.
Like in the movie Dog Day Afternoon.
Like in the movie Dog Day Afternoon, right? And a number of other movies, too, have shown this. So all I've done is I've taken that principle, which is very well known. I'm sure many of the listeners have heard about it. And I've applied it to history. And I asked the question, okay, when the European sailors and the European explorers went to the New World, they arrived in an absolute paradise in the Caribbean, in North America and South America. They arrived in a complete wonderland. This was really the New World. And I have to ask you to consider this question. Why didn't they just walk around with their jaw open and their eyes open like children, learning from the people who were there? Columbus said that the Indians he saw were the happiest people in the world, and it really puzzled him. Columbus admitted, because he couldn't figure out what they were happy about. But he didn't try to learn either. Why didn't those first Europeans have a coexistence, a peaceful coexistent curiosity toward the natives? No, instead, they immediately started to perpetrate genocide on them. Why did they do that? They did that because they came from 1,000 years of genocide in Europe, and they were simply repeating on others what had been done to them.
So the virus was spreading, and I think I can encapsulate this by saying that the Indians knew that life was equated with the earth and its resources, that America was a paradise, and they could not comprehend why the intruders from the East were determined to destroy all that was Indian as well as America itself.
And that's right.
It perpetuates even till this day.
That's right. It is perpetuated in this day by the great corporations. And often they use Christianity or one kind of another religious scam as their cover. But greed and this delusional form of religion, which the Gnostics exposed, go to hand in hand. And so it was really a double whammy. It was both those things that produced the destruction of the New World. And we're not at the end of it yet, but I'd say we're about 2 years away from the end of the complete destruction of the New World due to this this syndrome.
What is the Redeemer Complex?
The Redeemer Complex is the belief that there is something wrong with you that can only be corrected by a superhuman intervention. The Redeemer Complex is exemplified in its highest form in the figure of Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ is the Redeemer and the Savior. Those who believe in Jesus Christ believe that they cannot, out of their own self and their own person and character, fulfill their humanity. We are flawed. We are tainted by original sin, if you want to use that language. But there's something wrong with us morally. And the only way it can be corrected is by a superhuman power who comes in and sacrifices itself for us in some way, or else at the end of time judges us and condemns us to damnation or rewards us for having lived according to the rules dictated by the Messiah and the God who sent him. That is the Redeemer Complex. It's just a belief system. And many people have embraced that belief system. One of the things I point out in my book is, and this is not a kind thing I'm going to say now, so fasten your seatbelts, folks. That belief system is so devious and delusional and harmful that it corrupts your humanity to adopt it. But on the other hand, your humanity has to be pretty corrupted in the first place before you were even adopted. That's how bad it is. It's completely unnecessary. It has never helped anyone. It has never saved anyone. It has never improved the human condition. What improves the human condition is the natural goodness of people when it's allowed to express itself. We do not need a superhuman redeemer and some divine plan laid down by Big Daddy in the sky. This is what the Gnostics objected to. This is what they protested. And this is what I protest today.
And I have to tell you, I have a problem when you see a baby born. That is the definition of purity.
Yes.
And yet they're called a victim of the original sin, almost as if they're tainted.
That's right.
From the moment that they're born. But let me clarify that I don't mean the following comment to sound anti-religious. I respect everyone's beliefs. But it was Arthur C. Clarke who said, "The greatest tragedy in mankind's entire history may be the hijacking of morality by religion." To many people, the assumption that pagans were irreligious immediately implies that they were also immoral.
That's right.
Why is there a belief, John, that there can be no morality without a religious framework?
It's a scam. It's just a scam. There's nothing mysterious about it. There's nothing mystical about it. It doesn't require a secret societies using occult powers and casting a spell over humanity. It is just a scam. It is a scam to tell people that they can only know how to do the right thing if the rules are given to them by an unreachable off-planet authority. Because If someone accepts that, then they default on their own moral authority. If someone needs the rules of the Ten Commandments to tell them how to behave, and they need to believe that those rules come from a divine authority beyond the earth, then they have already defaulted on their own conscience. Because the truth is, only your own conscience can tell you what is right and wrong. That is how a human being is made. We're not made to follow rules that are fictitiously ascribed to some off-planet spiritual power. We're not made for that way. And those of us who adopt that program have put our own humanity at risk by doing so. I mean, this is a very deep thing. We're getting into some very deep things here. And these are disturbing points we're discussing, Mel. But these are exactly the points we need to discuss to get an appreciation, at least in this introduction we're doing, an appreciation of how profound this Gnostic message is. What a warning it contains. Yeah.
I was at a conference the other day and a lady said something that caught my attention. She said that animals were given instincts and humans were given intuition. But we have been so dumbed down that we can't use either or. But even Aldous Huxley and Carl Jung said that humans, left to their own proper instincts, will act in a morally responsible way.
That's right. And that was the platform of pagan morality as well. I challenge anyone here, if you really want to know what paganism is and to be a responsible person who is able to make your own judgment, read the Meditations of Marcus Aurelius. And this is a book you can read in 3 hours. It's a very thin book that contains like the personal journal of Marcus Aurelius, who was a Roman emperor and he was a pagan. And this book contains the essence of pagan ethics. And you will find in there, in the most simple language imaginable, love, truth, and trust in the natural goodness of human beings. We are all here to help each other. This is the essence of pagan ethics and morality.
And on this show, John, we always like to get to the truth. And by looking at the source of the problems, we can find a lot of truths. In talking with you tonight, I think of the late Terence McKenna, who defined the dominator culture as hierarchical, paternalistic, materialistic, male-dominated, and evolutionary maladaptive.
That's right.
Can we trace the patriarchal dominator system in the West to the Roman Empire?
We can trace it back before that to the rise of the theocracy in ancient Babylon and Sumeria. Theocracy is the source of our problem. And if you don't know what theocracy is, you don't understand it, it's probably hard for you to understand what's wrong in the world today. I'm not saying that the world is totally wrong, but some things are very, very wrong in our government, in our concept of society. And it all goes back to one thing, theocracy. Theocracy means the claim that the society is ruled by gods. That is to say, superhuman agencies beyond the earth. That is theocracy. And Judeo-Christian religion is just an expression of theocracy. It's a form of theocracy. The Vatican is a headquarters of theocracy, you know. And theocracy is wrong. There is no way you can spin it. It's wrong for our species. There is no way you can make it look good. And it has been used as an instrument of conquest, repression, genocide, and deception for thousands of years. And we must break out of theocracy into a true way of seeing the human story. And Terence was very aware of that, and he called that the dominator culture. Any culture that is produced from the theocracy concept is a dominator culture.
And John, we have to take our one and only intermission. Before we take the break, how do we get in touch with your work, all these great books?
Well, the main thing is metahistory.org has about 24 books on it itself, so you can go and delve into that. I suggest that you click on the site guide and just take a tour through the site to see what's in there. And then my book, latest book, Not in His Image, is really the one that contains the essence of what we're talking about this evening, and that's the place to go, the logical place to go from here.
I want to thank Jim Nichols, because he was the one who referred me to you and to the book Not in His Image. I cannot put it down. I got it a week ago, and I like to spend time reading a book so that I can absorb, and I will continue reading it. It is a wonderful book, and I highly recommend it. There are links on our website where you can get it too. Please don't go anywhere. We have so much more to cover. We have questions from the audience around the world and more discussions to take place here with John Lamb Lash. This is Mel Fabregas, and you're listening to Veritas. Don't go anywhere. Thank you very much for listening. We're going to talk more with our special guest in our members section. Head on over to our website, veritasshow.com, click on subscribe, and join us in the members area to tune in to the second part of this great show. We'll take a short break, listen to some music, and we'll be right back with more.
Bye. This is Michael Cremo, and you are listening to Veritas Radio. This is Michael Cremo, and you are listening to Veritas Radio.
Welcome back to Veritas. I'm here with John Lash. This is Mel Fabregas. And before the break, we were talking about the current events around the world and what has happened ever since the Dark Ages. But there's obviously some positives, something that Gnosticism can do to improve the way we live. John.
Certainly. One of the things that I set myself to do when I began to dig into these Gnostic materials was to find out what is really the message here, you know? What is the message? What is it that the Gnostics knew? What is it that they taught? And first of all, why was it so threatening to early Christians? Well, we've kind of covered that part of it. It's not because Gnostics, being pagans, hated Christians. Christians are just people. I don't hate Christians. It's a matter of warning the world about the belief system that Christians adopted. It's about the belief system, not about the people. And so we can see that there was a threat and that that threat had to be eliminated in order for the belief system to be imposed. But behind all that, the Gnostic message is still there, and I reconstructed it in my book. And to introduce what the Gnostic message is, I'd like to just spin around the corner for a moment and say something about my experience as a mythologist. If I might.
Of course.
You know, I'm a self-taught mythologist. I mean, people connect me with Mercer Eliade and Joseph Campbell, and that's very flattering because they were really big, big, you know, celebrities in the world. But I'm just a self-taught mythologist, and yet I have covered the same material that they covered. So I know what they know, and I have built on what they did. And Campbell and Eliade were both comparative mythologists, and that's relatively rare. At any time, I would say there can't be more than half a dozen or maybe 10 comparative mythologists on the planet. It's a very rare vocation. Most people who study mythology in order to teach it in the university or write about it will concentrate on one particular subject, like Greek mythology or Native American or Aztecs or Eskimo mythology, whatever. A comparative mythologist like myself looks at myths from all the cultures and ages of the world. Polynesia, China, Siberia, Greece, Rome, Ireland, South America. Look at all of the mythologies and compare them. I have to tell you something that happened to me in the course of my life. In the process of doing this, naturally, I have explored hundreds, probably thousands of myths, but let's say 200 or so myths that I've looked at very, very closely from all these different cultures, and I've compared the characters in them and compared the themes. So I've had a chance through my entire life to make what you could call a really thorough inventory of the myths in the world. And I find that there is, of course, much truth in these myths. They're not just fictions or fabrications, but they are stories that teach us how to live. And they contain and are often coded with very powerful information. But I would say that the most amazing experience that I've had in this field is the discovery of one myth that is completely incomparable. There is no other myth that comes close to it. It's unique. It's coherent. It's cogent. And it is, as far as I know, the only complete planetary myth that our species has produced. The only complete planetary myth. I want you to know what I mean by that. If you go into any area of mythology, for instance, Japanese mythology or Polynesian or Greek mythology, you will find creation myths because all of these cultures describe the creation of the world. So there are many, many creation myths of different kinds, but there is only one complete creation myth that describes the origin of the planet Earth. And that is really amazing. I don't know if I can impress upon you how amazing that is. It certainly, for me, it was a revelation. And where did I find that myth? I found it in these repressed Gnostic writings. And that is the myth of the fallen goddess.
Would you say that you are demythologizing history?
I would say that I don't know exactly what you mean by that. I'm, as a mythologist, I look at the way that history has been told. And yes, I want to remove from history some of the mythology that has been attached to it.
Exactly.
That I would consider to be toxic or delusional. But the amazing thing is, there is this unique myth of the, it's called, I call it the fallen goddess scenario. And it was the center piece of the whole movement of Gnosticism. And this myth has a story that explains the origin of the human species, the origin of our planet, the nature and presence of the divine intelligence of our planet, the presence of extraterrestrial predators upon humanity, the origin of those predators, the nature of their behavior, their description, and their intentions toward humanity. And the myth also explains the special relation of humanity to the planet Earth, to the Earth goddess, whose name is Sophia. So whereas you might find in other cultures, in other origin myths, fragments and hints of these factors in the scenario, in the Gnostic myth of the fallen Sophia, you have the entire story intact. And there's nothing like it that I have ever seen. So I would say that in my experience as a comparative mythologist, this is the most amazing thing I've ever seen.
And I know you want to focus on the positive aspects of Gnosticism, but I also want to continue giving the audience a little bit of a background.
Sure.
Right now we have censorship in the media. We know that. There are a few shows like ours that we're able to do what we have to do unfiltered. But the time may come where we maybe have to be licensed in order to be able to operate.
Have an internet site.
Exactly.
Yeah, that's right.
So I really don't see any difference between the Romans, the conquistadors, and other invasions or certain revolutions. In order to conquer people, you have to get rid of their intellectuals and destroy their cultural knowledge. Do you see that happening today?
Precisely. Precisely. That is, what is happening today is the last chapter of what we saw with the death of Hypatia. The way to destroy a culture is to destroy the intellectuals. That means the people who carry the intelligence of that culture, the teachers of that culture, the people who teach the members of the culture to think for themselves, to be responsible and reasonable, to question authority. You know, the way you control and overcome a society is by destroying those people and censoring what they have to say. And that's what was done with the Gnostics. But fortunately, for some reason, these books that were found in the desert in Egypt in 1945, survived. And they're very fragmentary and chaotic. In fact, they're a terrible mess. I talk about that in the book. I explain the Nag Hammadi codices are a mess. But out of it's sort of like I often compare it to a handful of fragments of a great, beautiful mosaic. And you have to construct the picture that was in the mosaic from this handful of fragments, because somebody blew the mosaic up, you see? But it can be done. And when it's done, we get this fantastic vision story. I believe that this vision story is unique, and that is the story that is able to guide our species toward its proper role in evolution, toward its proper role and its proper place in the cosmos. And no other story can do that like this particular story.
And you talk about the Nag Hammadi, we can think of the Sumerian tablets, but John, I think of where we store our knowledge today, computer hard drives,
right,
silicon chips,
right,
CDs, DVDs, etc. Not a very reliable way to preserve our knowledge in the event of a natural disaster or man-made catastrophe. Don't you think And how would you deal with this if something were to happen? How would you preserve our knowledge today?
Well, the way that I can tell you, the way that Gnostics preserved the knowledge that they had of this divine being, Sophia. One thing I would like to say, though, in regard to Gnostics, before we continue, is a little point of correction that's actually quite important. And I make this point in my book. The people that we're talking about, these Gnostics, actually never used that word to describe themselves. So we're calling them by a name that they did not call themselves. In fact, the word Gnostic, I don't know if you came across this passage in the book yet, Mel, but the word Gnostic is really meant as an insult. It literally means a knower, but to the people who used it, it means a know-it-all or smartass.
Mm.
Oh, those Gnostics, meaning those know-it-alls, those smartasses. That's how actually it was used by the early Christian ideologues and church fathers. When the Gnostics came out and confronted them about their belief system, said, hey, you know, we don't think that this idea of a redeemer coming from the supernatural father to save us is really a good idea. We think it's wrong. We think it's delusional. And we've had a pretty long experience in spiritual practices, you know. And the early Christians turned around and said, oh, you know it all, you smart ass. Don't think you can tell us what to believe in. You see? It was an insult. And it's really important today, if we want to recapture the spirit of the Gnostics, is to know what they called themselves. And they called themselves telestai, T-E-L-E-S-T-A-I. And that is from the Greek root telos, meaning aim or purpose. And what telestai means, it's such a beautiful word, it means those who are aimed. We are aimed, like an arrow is aimed. So the Gnostics called themselves, they accepted that label, but it's a kind of a derogatory label. They called themselves telestai because they all shared a common vision, and that vision is what aimed them. In other words, their practice of spirituality, if you will, and their practices in life as teachers and guides to the world was all based on how they were aimed, how they were directed by this story. So this story, which I reconstructed from the Nag Hammadi materials, is really the secret and the essence of the Gnostic vision of life. Story of the fallen goddess, Sophia.
Is Sophia equal Gaia, the living planet?
Yes, Sophia is, what they call Sophia is what we would today call Gaia. So I have kind of coined this term, Gaia Sophia, to put those two together. And what the Gnostics meant by Sophia, it's very, very simple. It's the name of a feminine energy, if you want to call it that, a powerful feminine energy, goddess energy, that actually had its home, you could say, in the center of our galaxy. This is very, very source-specific information, Mel. The Gnostic fallen Sophia story is specifically about the planet Earth and the galaxy that we are in. So most people know that we are now in a four- or five-armed lenticular spiral galaxy with a population of about 200 billion suns circulating in the arms of the galaxy. Most people also know that the core of the galaxy, or the hub, is a pure mass of molten white light. And then the arms of the galaxy are like pinwheel formations spiraling around that core. The Gnostic vision story is about what happened in our galaxy. It's about a force that originates in the center and that burst out of the center of the galaxy and flowed into the spiraling arms and eventually formed itself into a planet. So the name Sophia is the name that the Gnostics gave to our planet before it actually became a planet. It is the name of the energy that formed our planet. And that energy is metaphorically or mythologically described as a goddess force. Sophia, which means wisdom. The word Sophia means wisdom.
I'm even surprised that this knowledge was able to be preserved with the amount of crimes that were committed against the Gnostics and those who were pagans. But can we categorically say, and not to undermine the loss of life and the crimes,
sure,
that the best example of intellectual cleansing was the burning of the Library of Alexandria? And was it Julius Caesar who ordered the burning?
Well, there's a lot of debate about that, and people at the time take different sides on it. He certainly did order the burning of it, or at one point he was escaping from the city and he needed.
Can you repeat that? I'm losing you. Can you hear me okay?
Julius Caesar was fighting. Yeah, okay. I'm back.
Okay.
Am I back now?
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. People in antiquity have different views about whether Caesar really did it or not. He certainly was likely to have set the library on fire as a diversion when he was trying to escape the city and possibly the fire got out of control. The greatest example, intellectual.
Losing you, John. Can I hang up and call you back to get a better line?
Sure.
Okay. Let me do that.
Yeah. Hello.
When a very important topic is touched, a lot of times we go through these strange
Isn't
interruptions.
That Isn't that true? Yeah. Well, get back to the question you asked me. Would this be an example of intellectual genocide?
Yes.
Yeah, something like that was the question you had asked.
Well, basically, in your opinion, what was the reason for the burning mm-hmm. of the library? Was it the Christianized Roman Empire, if we cannot point it at one person?
The burning of the Library of Alexandria and the destruction of hundreds of other similar libraries and the centuries-long campaign to destroy every single scroll and document that came from the mystery schools, which were the spiritual universities led by the Gnostics, was intentional, and it was done to eliminate that knowledge, because if that knowledge were allowed to coexist with the belief system of Christianity, people would not have chosen Christianity. They would have chosen the other way, because it's more sane, you see. So the option had to be eliminated. It's just like 9/11. You look at 9/11, and now in the perspective of 9 years, it's so obvious that those buildings could not have fallen down in the way they did from being hit by airplanes. And it's so obvious that 19 Arabs with box cutters could not have hijacked those planes and flown them into those buildings. And many pilots have testified that it's impossible. But we were not allowed to think otherwise, were we? We were not. At the moment that it happened, a story was put out, and you were not allowed to think otherwise. And it's the same thing. At the moment that the belief system of Christianity was put out, people were not allowed to think otherwise. The destruction of pagan intellectual and spiritual culture is the greatest act of genocide, of intellectual genocide that's ever happened in history. And it went on for centuries.
When I come back to 1,000 years later, a parallel drama played out. You said that Indians were robbed and murdered at pleasure because the Christians,
right,
whites, were not held accountable for the abuse of non-Christians. Isn't this happening today with other religions too?
Certainly it is. Said religion, as it calls itself, is something you've got to put into question. You have to ask yourself, well, what is religion? If religion is a teaching, a program that gives a person an opportunity or option to follow their spiritual life, then that's fine. But if religion is a pretext to murder, destroy, rape, and control other people, what kind of religion is that? And unfortunately, that's pretty much what religion is about. You know, don't even have to mention the word Zionism. Don't even have to mention the word Israel, where all this began, by the way, because the Redeemer complex came out of Palestine. It was a virus. It was a delusional virus that came out of Palestine, as I explained in my book. And it came out of the region of the Dead Sea Scrolls and out of that culture So certainly it just takes a little common sense to say that if religion is a practice of goodness and coexistence and love, how can it possibly support and endorse these behaviors, this thing?
Absolutely. And just a quick parenthesis here. If the Romans proceeded with the crucifixion of Jesus Christ, how did the whole Roman Empire merge into the Catholic Church?
Well, it's very easy. You just go look at the Emperor Constantine. Mm-hmm. He's the one who made the marriage pact. He made Christianity state religion. And why did he do that? Because the Roman Empire was falling apart, and it had lost its become destabilized. It was purely political. Christianity is just it's just politics. It's just used for political reasons, just the same way as the state of Israel is used for political reasons. It doesn't have anything to do with the religion, true religion of the Hebrews, whatever that was. So Constantine just said, wow, I need a solution here. My authority as a Roman emperor is in question. Aha! This new belief system of Christianity claims the authority of a spiritual Father God beyond the earth. No one can question the authority of this Father God. Well, I'll just say that my authority and his are the same.
I love it how you connect the dots, John. But one synchronistic event that caught my eye while reading your book, Not in His Image, was the, since you mentioned Israel, was the one that first, the first seven Dead Sea Scrolls text found were identified by scholars at the very moment when the United Nations voted to form the State of Israel in November of 1947.
Absolutely mind-boggling.
And what did it say? Behold my people, I mean to raise you from your graves and lead you back to the soil of Israel. How coincidental can that be?
That's right. That ain't no coincidence. So that's a cosmic coincidence. Right. I want to point out, by the way, and I think this will be helpful to people coming toward this material, because this is really dense and difficult material. I'll tell you, this is sorting this stuff out has been hard, and I hope I've done a pretty good job of it. But one thing that you need to understand is that the Nag Hammadi texts, which preserve Gnostic teachings or the teachings of the Telestai, were found in Egypt in 1945, and they are written in Coptic. Don't confuse them with the Dead Sea Scrolls. These were found in Israel in 1947, and they were written in ancient Hebrew and Aramaic and a couple of other obscure languages. And so the Dead Sea Scrolls don't have anything to do with the Gnostics and the Telestai of paganism. The Dead Sea Scrolls are the documents of a sect of very radical, xenophobic, militaristic Jews who lived near Jerusalem in the first centuries of the Christian era. And the interesting thing, Mel, is that actually there are some references in the Nag Hammadi writings to that cult. There are some interconnections between the Dead Sea material and the Nag Hammadi material, and I've developed them in my book. But even more interesting than that, I believe, is that there is a connection between the Nag Hammadi Gnostic materials and the Sumerian Anunnaki material.
Huh.
That's really interesting.
Yes.
And that's probably the deal breaker for our species. I'm getting the feeling lately that that Sumerian Anunnaki script is the deal breaker for our species. Where you stand on that story is pretty much where you stand on your own humanity. So be very careful about looking at that story.
How much credence do you give to that and to the Zachariah Sitchin's work?
Well, let me ask you this. You told me that you did the last interview with Zachariah Sitchin, right?
Yes, yes.
Yeah. And I'm sure that other people that you've interviewed have talked about the Anunnaki script, the Anunnaki story.
Yes.
Which is basically, as Sitchin puts it, cuneiform writing on clay tablets dating from about 1800 BC tell the story of an advanced extraterrestrial race that came to Earth, found an indigenous species, modified its DNA, and that the purpose of that genetic intervention by the Anunnaki was to turn humanity, the indigenous species, into a slave species.
Right.
Right. Okay. Would you say that's a fair synopsis?
Absolutely. That is the best summary. Yes.
Okay. Now, I think, Mel, that we'd probably have to dedicate another entire interview to this subject, but I'm going to give you my best shot. Okay. Just for now. When you read the Nag Hammadi documents, there's 52 of them. What you want to do is you want to go on metahistory.org and go to the Nag Hammadi reading plan, where I cull it down to 32 of them, because actually there's a lot of junk and confusion in them. They're really in bad shape. And so 32 of them are enough to get the essential picture. And I've written commentaries on 18, the first 18 of these 32. When you look into these Nag Hammadi codices, you find that about 6 of them are cosmological documents. That is, they contain versions of the Gnostic cosmology and the Gnostic myth, how the planet Earth originated, how humanity originated, what produced the presence of certain alien predator-like beings in our solar system. This is explicitly explained. The Gnostic writings are the only texts that I have ever seen that explain the origin, nature, and intentions of this predatory alien species, which they call archons. And they describe 2 types of archons, a reptilian type and what I call a neonate or embryonic type, that is, would resemble the gray aliens insofar as they resemble a prematurely born fetus, right? They look like a human body looks if it's born prematurely.
Sure.
Both of these types are indicated in the Gnostic cosmological writings and in the story of the history of our planet. And the amazing thing also is that some of the Gnostic cosmological texts, such as On the Origin of the World, or the reality of the archons, you find them in my website with my commentaries. Some of these texts describe the same incidents that are described in the Sumerian cuneiform record, but they describe them in a completely different way. I'll give you one example. It is widely claimed by David Icke and other people who are pushing Sitchin's material, putting forth the Sumerian script as if it is a true story of ancient times. It is claimed by those people that 2 of these Anunnaki, Enki and his half-sister, genetically mingled their genes with human genes. Okay? Well, in the Gnostic version, it says that the archons, which I would identify as the Anunnaki, I make that identification, what are called the archons in the Gnostic materials are the same as the Anunnaki in the Sumerian. Okay? Mm-hmm. The Gnostic materials say, and get this, this is truly amazing. Oh, well, they tried, but they couldn't do it. They tried to interfere. They tried to interbreed, but they couldn't do it. It failed. Now, that is an amazing statement. And you asked me what I think of Sitchin. I have been reading Sitchin since I could, suck on a lollipop, I read Sitchin as long as he was written. And I've discussed him and talked about his work with many, many people. Basically, I would say this. Just because something is written in cuneiform on clay tablets 3,800 years ago doesn't mean it's true. Just because it's written doesn't mean it's a true account of what actually happened. And I don't believe it is. In fact, I believe that the whole Sumerian story of the Anunnaki creating humanity as a slave species is a disinformation scam.
That was my next question. If you thought it was a disinformation.
It is it's an ancient disinformation scam. And I can tell you exactly why that scam, why I believe that that is a scam, who introduced that scam, and why they introduced that scam. And I've studied this very, very closely. But I want to say before I go into those points that if I speak with any confidence at all about this, and this is a really important subject, my friend, this is really big, and if I speak with any kind of confidence, not authority, because I'm not imposing my view, it's because I've really got the clue from the Gnostic materials. The Gnostic materials critique the Sumerian Sitchin story and tell you what's not true about it. Now, how could that be? How could it be that we would have some information from this ancient source, information coming from people who were much closer to that story than we are? The Gnostics were from the Levant. The core of the Gnostic groups were from the Middle East and from Syria and Iran and Iraq. And they had been in those countries for thousands of years. The Gnostic movement goes back to about 6,000 BC. And isn't it interesting that from those people who were experts in evolutionary history, who were shamans and seers, who studied the prehistory of the earth in teams of people over many generations, they were experts, that they would turn around and say, watch out, because this story is a lie. They tried to interfere with our genetic evolution, but they could not. We are not slaves because we were genetically manipulated to be. We're slaves because we're stupid. That's what a Gnostic would say. Gnostic would say that you have in yourself, you are not divine. Your ego is not divine. Even yourself is not divine. But every human being has a germ, a seed of divinity, and that is called nous. Your intelligence is divine. The intelligence of humanity is a divine faculty planted in us. This is a Gnostic teaching. And they would say, there is no evil. There are predators and mind parasites who interfere and try to insinuate themselves into the human mind. They do exist, but there is basically no evil in the cosmos, and we are not slaves except by our own doing, by enslaving ourselves, because we do not develop that germ of divine intelligence. This is the message of Gnosticism, and it bears very, very closely on the claims that are being so widely made based on Sitchin's work. So I think that Gnosticism really is worth looking into here, because it gives us a platform and an ability to critique the Sumerian Sitchin story.
And I thought that you were going to discuss the archons in the future, but I'm glad you brought the subject up.
In this context, I think it would, they deserve a separate treatment. But in this context, I felt it necessary to bring them up because I have made the connection that the Anunnaki, which many, many people know about, are the archons. And not many people know about the archons.
No, they don't. By the way, I like how you have a glossary in your book, His Image. And you define archons, just for the audience, from the Greek for first, from the beginning, inorganic species produced by the impact of Sophia or Sophia upon elementary matter before Sophia turned into the earth. Cyborgs inhabiting the solar system at large who excel in the psychotechnology of virtual reality, intrude upon humanity by psychic stealth, and propagate the ideological virus of redemptive religion. Entraps intrapsychic forces that exaggerate human error beyond the scale of correction. Or as Jack Vallée would say, messengers of deception.
Messengers of deception. They are messengers of deception. This disinformation scam is not difficult to understand, actually. I'd like to just take a moment to try to explain that, if I might, because I know that many of your listeners have heard about the Anunnaki scenario. And this Anunnaki scenario, largely through David Icke, is getting more and more. It's getting massive exposure, you know. It's getting to the point where it's going to be competing with, you know, conventional religions, you know. It's really getting big. And so I'd like to explain as briefly as I can why I consider it to be a disinformation scam. When theocracy arose in the Middle East, in ancient Babylon, in the Fertile Crescent, around 4000 BC, it was a system of social organization that came along with agriculture. With agriculture and with organized agriculture, city-states arose. With city-states, you needed the organization of society. And also with agriculture, you had surplus goods. So trade arose. People had more grain than they could use. They were no longer simply bartering with their neighbors. And in this whole complex development, theocracy arose as a form of social control and social organization. And the first theocrats, if they were going to impose their authority on these up-and-coming cities, on the first urban centers, how were they going to do that? What was going to be the basis of their authority in the new societies, the new urban societies that were emerging also in Egypt? Well, it's well known, and many historians point this out, that rulers in the ancient Middle East always had advisors who were called Chaldeans, usually. And the word Chaldean in ancient history meant a soothsayer, which means in our time, a psychic or a channeler. So, you know, I don't know if you've heard this fact, Mel, but Ronald Reagan was guided by an astrologer.
Yes.
Did you know that?
Yes, through his wife.
Yeah, his wife, Nancy, had an astrologer. And this astrologer, for instance, told Ronald Reagan the exact time of day and the exact day when he should meet with Gorbachev to discuss blah, blah, blah. Okay? So imagine that the people in the White House are being advised by astrologers, but not only by astrologers, but also by psychics, by channelers. Imagine Ramtha is in the White House giving advice to the president and his cabinet. Okay? This is maybe not such a wild idea. Who knows? You know? But in ancient theocracies, this was absolutely the case. Because, in fact, the men who were attracted to power in those times didn't really know how to rule society. It was a new game, and they didn't know how to impose their authority. So they relied on astrologers, soothsayers, and channelers. I'm not making this up. This is a well-known historical fact. Well, what did the channeler sitting in the court before the Babylonian king, what did the channeler tell the king? The channeler goes into a trance, just like channelers today. And the channeler has a job to fulfill. The psychic or channeler, in order to keep his or her position in the king of the court, needs to deliver to the king a message that the king is going to like. Well, what better message to give him than to say that he is a special progeny, not like other human beings, but he's actually the result of generation by the gods. He can claim that his ancestors were gods, and that gives him the right to rule. So this whole scenario of the Anunnaki gods interbreeding with humanity is simply a way to legitimate theocracy. It's a made-up story to legitimate theocracy and to give those early rulers a power of authority that could not be questioned. And they would say, we are the descendants of the Anunnaki. First, the Anunnaki was here, but they're gone now. That's the whole thing. Why did they go? Where did they go? When did they go? You know, none of this is really clear. Sitchin is not really clear about that. I believe that at one point he mentions a date about when the Anunnaki, you know, departed the earth or something. But basically, the story that he's working with that was written down on these cuneiform tablets is a channeled information that was fed to the theocrats of that time to feed their egos and to legitimate their rulership over the emerging urban societies. And I think that if we uncritically today buy that story, we are in fact placing ourselves into the scenario of enslavement. We are writing a script that makes us slaves. And I don't believe that that script is true. We're not slaves of any extraterrestrial species. And it has never been proven, nor can it be proven, that anyone messed with our DNA, because in order to prove that scientifically, we would have to have a pre-intervention DNA.
Before and after, right.
That's right. So it's an unprovable hypothesis. And people who think, like Kerner and other people, Nigel Kerner and other people who think that they can see in our DNA the proof of this intervention, are really fooling themselves. It is an unprovable proposition. And it's also a proposition that's very, very dangerous. Because if we believe this story, considering the power of imagination of our species, which is something the Gnostics talked about a lot, if we believe this story, we could end up fulfilling this story simply because we believe in it. Do you understand what I mean?
Sure.
We could end up enslaving ourselves because we buy this story and we make it into our reality. So this is a real deal breaker. Where are we going to go with this Anunnaki script? And I would suggest to everyone who has heard about this Anunnaki story and has been fascinated by it, you know, one way or another, before you make up your mind, read what I say about it in my book and read the Gnostic critique of the Anunnaki story. Read their version of what they said happened. Read their version. You know, the Gnostic texts are the only surviving writings from the ancient past that assert that the alien predators, these archons, are liars. They rule by deception, they use hoax and fraud, and we actually have power over them, not them over us.
Before we continue with the archons, Planet X or Nibiru, what's your take on that?
Right. That's another weak point, a real weak point. It's a huge weak point in Sitchin's scenario. In the first place, if you take a 3,600-year cycle, you go back and look in history, there is, it's very, very hard to find anything that happened that would correspond to the presence of such a body in the solar system. Look at what's happening today. Look at the clips on the internet. Look at the rumors flying around. The return of Nibiru is nothing but fabrication and fabulation. It's scaremongering. It's opportunities for people to hoax other people and say, the planet's going down, come and buy our products so that you can hide away in a hole in the ground. You see?
Y2K.
It's being used.
Y2K.
Yeah. I don't believe that there is any Nibiru, and I don't believe that there's any scientific verification for Nibiru. I've not seen any.
Same with 2012.
2012, first of all, the date is wrong. Recently, a team of Mayan scholars recalculated that date, which is called the Martinez Goodman Thompson date, which was established in the 1930s. Now, this is a long story, but that date, putting the end of the Mayan calendar at 2012, has been around for about 70 years. But recently a team of scholars said, hey, wait a minute, I think we're going to go back and look at the information again, look at the stelae on which they relied on for their time parameters, recalculate it, and they came out 200 years later, 2208. I think that there is nothing essentially special about 2012, but the very fact that it has been made a focus of so much attention now makes it special. It is now special, but it's not special because it was indicated to be so by the Maya. That's a complete error, in my opinion.
I want to take this opportunity to ask you something that may put some people in an uncomfortable position. But I've talked to people who say that indeed companies like Bechtel, which happen to own most of the Dead Sea Scrolls. You probably know this.
Yes, that's right.
They have been building underground facilities for decades, billions or maybe trillions of dollars. Could the powers that want to be use the date or the time of 2012 to come up with a false flag, nothing that we've ever witnessed before, in order to thin the herd, and they just go downstairs, hide for a while things get better on the surface? Is there a possibility in your mind?
Well, it's with great sadness in my heart that I would answer in this way. Yes, I really believe this to be so. And this is the end game of human insanity. These people are insane. I think it should be clear by now that if there is a group or globalist elite or whatever you want to call them, the globalist mafioso, people who are controlling things at that level of power where they command armies and where they can ruin countries and orchestrate financial disasters, you know, if such a group of people exists, they are insane. But they are also insanely clever, unfortunately. And I do strongly believe that all the signs are pointing to exactly that. I do believe it. All the signs are pointing to them using that date as a focal point, probably a little before that date, because they have to do it by surprise.
Right.
Is a focal point for a staged doomsday event, just like 9/11 was staged. It was staged, and they will stage a doomsday event. And in this doomsday event, in the battle that takes place, there'll be a lot of collateral damage. And I'm very, very sorry to say this, and I wish that this would not happen. And I believe that it doesn't have to happen. But the insane vision that is drawing humanity toward that day has to be broken, and another vision has to be put in its place. It's our responsibility that day should never come. It's the responsibility of every person who holds humanity in their heart and believes in the divinity and magic of the human species to see that day would never come. But how are we going to counter that insanity? That is the question. How are we going to counteract that insanity? Because it's got a lot of momentum behind it, baby.
Right.
It's got a lot of momentum. It's a juggernaut, and it's a rolling toward its destination, you know?
Do you have a tangible solution that you have come up with?
Yes, I do. I believe that one of the greatest gifts and the greatest potentials of the human species, of the human being, is magic. And I'm going to put my reputation on the line right here with you now, and I'm going to tell you that I believe that the solution for humanity, the breaking out of the global insanity endgame into a real future for humanity, has to be a magical solution. Because it's magic that's taking us to annihilation. It's a kind of black magic. It's a kind of magic that's played like the magic of serial killers, and the magic of people who are criminally insane. They have a kind of powerful magic. And we, who do not want to see humanity go down that road, have to find the magic that is the counterforce to their magic. This is what I believe. And I also believe, I wouldn't say that unless I thought I could deliver what the elements of that magic are. What I could suggest to you, that the elements of that magic that represents the true spirit of humanity and the beauty and inspiration and creativity of our species is based in the Gnostic scenario of the divine Sophia. It's all in there. That story can be the framework and the foundation for our magic, for our higher evolutionary shift. I'm convinced of it. I'm totally convinced.
And John, I have a few questions for members of the audience. And this one says, regarding the Archons, are they still here with us? And if so, do you think we'll ever be rid of them?
Well, the Archons, according to the Gnostic story now, again, I'm not making this up. I'm telling you what is indicated in the framework of their story, are always present. They inhabit the solar system. They arose as a kind of locust-like species when the solar system was formed. You see, one of the things that the Gnostic cosmology teaches is that the Earth doesn't belong to the solar system. It's only captured in it. And this explains why the Earth is completely different from the other planets in our solar system. That is, that the other planets are basically inorganic. They may have some organic life of a microscopic kind or some underground life, but they do not have large, medium-sized, and small animals running around on the surface. Only we have that. Why? Because the planet Earth is the embodiment of the goddess Sophia, who is a divine force from the center of the galaxy. And everything that is in the body of Sophia is alive and organic. So the Earth was created by a completely different process than the rest of the planets in the solar system. And the archons belong to the other part of the planetary system. And they're fine. They have their place. But when they try to interfere with us, when they cross the boundary and try to interfere in the human realm, that's when we get into trouble. So, yeah, they're here, but they're not a problem if they stay in their own realm. And Gnostics taught also, and this is explicitly described, so at metahistory.org, how to encounter these beings and how to repel them, how, in fact, to send them back to where they came from and to tell them to leave you alone. And if people who had been abducted by aliens and undergone these nightmarish experiences, which happened, by the way, in virtual reality, because the archons are masters of virtual reality, which is called in the Gnostic text, Coptic language, hal, H-A-L, simulation. In these horrible simulated experiences and these 3D hallucinations, if the people who were subjected to them followed the Gnostic advice, they would put these Archon entities in their place and tell them where to get off. And I can do it. I've done it myself many times. Anyone can do it. So they're not a threat to us as long as we know our own story and our relation to the planet and to the planetary goddess is strong. They can't threaten us in any way.
And Laurie asks also, to what extent are they just a projection of the collective human mind as compared to actual physical entities? Or asked another way, do we self-perpetuate their existence through our collective fear-based thinking, therefore ensuring we'll never be rid of them?
You see, Laurie, this is such a beautiful question. And the syntax of your language and the way you phrase your question shows that you have a Gnostic mind, that you have the ability for critical thinking in regard to supernatural matters. I've been asked this question many times, and the best answer that I can give is that it is both. It is both. It is not either or, it is both. In one respect, they are a projection of our collective unconscious and of the fear that we have of anything that is alien and non-human, which keeps us in isolation from the rest of the universe. Until we overcome that fear, we're never going to really know, as a culture, collectively, who's out there. On the other hand, that power of human imagination and projection is so great that it can support the existence of autonomous entities. Do you get that? It can support the existence of autonomous entities who actually live out, are born out of the human imagination. So they are actually a physical, semi-physical presence, and they are just a projection of our minds. They're both.
And this one comes from Anne in the UK. John, you said in an interview that we are now in a time when there is nothing sacred left except the organic light. I would be grateful if you could explain more about this. And also, is it possible to experience it without the use of mind-altering substances?
Beautiful question, and I'm so grateful for these questions. First of all, the organic light is what I call the primary substance body of the divine Sophia. The Gnostic creation myth says that our planet was not created like the rest of the solar system from a disturbance in the galactic limbs, a churning of elementary matter. Our planet was created by a power surge from the galactic center. This is what the Gnostic creation myth says. And that power surge was a great plume of light, living light, which I call the organic light. And at the end of that plume, like at the tip of a spout of water, the earth formed and materialized. And the goddess, which is a name for that plume of energy, the goddess metamorphosed herself into the earth. So the goddess Sophia has two bodies. One of them is the earth you see, the clouds, the atmosphere you breathe, the trees, the oceans, the mountains. But she retains her cosmic pleromic body of pure light. And you can encounter her in that body. And that was the central experience of the mystery schools. It was the supreme experience of the Gnostics. Their practice was to go into a visionary state and see the pure, milky white, organic light that is present everywhere on this planet. And that was a direct encounter from the goddess, with the goddess. And their practice was to be instructed by that light, to be taught by the goddess. Yes, there are ways to experience it spontaneously, and there are ways to experience it without the use of psychoactive plants, but they are rare, and the general practice in the mysteries that was observed for thousands of years by these teams of shamans is to use the sacred plants as emissaries and guides. The reason being very simple, you might have a meditative practice that can get you so much out of your ego self that you will be able to behold the organic light, but it's not easy to do. Whereas the plant emissaries will take you out of your ego self and take you to the light. And that's why they were used, because they are reliable for that purpose. And they were given to us by the Gaia for that purpose, I believe. Yeah.
And also says, in the same interview, you said beautiful anarchy is the answer to problems on this planet. But in an essay on your site, you make reference to rage being a better way to defeat the powers that be than love. Can you expand on these points?
Yes, I don't believe. There's one thing that really makes me very suspicious about David Icke, and by that I don't mean that there's something wrong with the guy or that he's a double agent or anything. But what I really can't buy about his presentation, there are certain things I can't buy, that the reptilians are ruling us, that our genetics were shut down so that we can't perceive the divine worlds. I don't buy that at all. It's not true. I perceive the divine world any day of the week. But what I really object to is his premise that if we project love toward these sick, disgusting, psychopathic control freaks, that it's going to make any difference. That is completely wrong, and I'm very suspicious of that message. Rage is part of our animal nature as a human being. The rage that you would feel if someone attacked your child, the rage that you would feel if someone tried to burn or torture someone that you loved or torture you. And that rage is what we need to direct, not toward the archons, not toward some reptilian species from outer space, but toward the perpetrators on this planet who are just as human as we are. And that rage is the power with which we can meet them and defeat them. But I point out that the expression of that rage can be through ritual and magical forms and not by direct violence against them. It's a very important point I make.
And this one, thank you for your unparalleled study of the, I'm going to call it Sophia, because that's how you call it, the unparalleled study of Sophia myth and Gnostic perspective. Could you expand upon your concept that the Gnostic mystics may have introduced the idea of the Antichrist as a way to derail the viral spread of Christianity? It is a novel and brilliant insight that I would love to hear more about.
God, I'm so glad. You know, this is making my day. I'm so happy to hear that there are people out there who have followed me, listened to my last Red Ice interview, and you have the sobriety and the clarity to ask me these questions. It's so good for me. You know, I really went out on a limb on my last Red Eye interview by bringing this up. I wasn't really prepared to back up what I said, but I'll just repeat in a sentence. I said that I have a strong feeling that the notion of the Antichrist, which you find in the New Testament and in Revelation, was a sabotage device planted in the Christian belief system by Gnostics, and that it's not going to work. The Antichrist idea, Christians think the Antichrist idea will work in one way, but actually, if it is a sabotage device, it's going to work in another way. The way they think it's going to work is, oh, the script says the moment of apocalypse is coming, and first there'll be a false Christ, the Antichrist, but we'll see that he's false, and then the real Christ, the real Savior, will come. That's how they think the script is going to work. But if I'm correct that it was a Gnostic plant, it will work this way. First, they'll see the false Christ. And then when that false Christ is exposed, they'll realize that all the Christs are false, that all messiahs are false, and they will be liberated from the need to be saved by a messiah. I mean, this is the liberation that we need on this planet, to be liberated from the need to be saved by a messiah. And maybe that Antichrist trick could be in there for that purpose. It's a wild card. It's a wild card. But I'm very grateful that someone called me on that card.
And I've told our audience to, and we have very smart people in our audience worldwide, as you can
really
tell.
Do.
And I've told them to be concise with their questions, but some of the material you cover is so vast that they have to give a little bit of background. For example, this one says, John, in your book, you describe the Gnostics' ecological mythology story, the sacred story of Sophia. That mythology details the coevolution of Gaia and the human species and how the sacred mating of Sophia and Christos created Anthropos, or the human template, which were the seeds of humanity and the roots of our species. And this seed originated in the center of our galaxy and eventually emerged in the carousel arm of our galaxy and manifested into our human species of today. It continues. Juxtaposed to this concept, there is currently a popular meme concerning the roots of the human species, which takes various forms depending on the researcher, but essentially theorizes that our human species was engineered some hundreds of thousands of years ago by some other advanced species for their own purposes, i.e. as a slave race, etc. My question, do you give any credence to the idea we were engineered this way, and what are your thoughts as to the origination of our human species?
Right. I am convinced that the Gnostic creation myth of the fallen Sophia, which describes the generation of the human template, the genome or anthropos from the galactic center, is correct. I am convinced it is true and that it is scientifically correct, and that is actually what happened. And from the center of the galaxy, the genome is seeded in worlds that arise in the carousel limbs. As far as the genetic engineering scenario goes, it's not something that goes back into the misty dawn of prehistory. It's a recent story that sprung up about 4000 BC. It was recorded in cuneiform clay tablets around 1800 BC, and it's a disinformation scam. Don't believe that we were genetically engineered by a superior race somewhere else in the galaxy or from another galaxy. And if you look at, as I said, if you look at the Gnostic creation myths on metahistory.org, you'll see that the Gnostics specifically refuted that. They said, yes, the Archons, who are the alien predator types in our solar system, attempted to do that, but they failed. They were not able to access the human genome, and I believe that is the truth.
In this one, are the Gnostic records regarding how the Archon mind might shape human personality? Do each of us reflect personal characteristics, fears, hopes, dreams that are not our own?
Definitely. One of the sentences that you find in my book, which is a synopsis of Gnostic teaching, is not everything that arises in the human mind originates there. So certainly you have thoughts that go through your mind that are not your own. You have thoughts that belong to your parents. You have thoughts that are planted in your mind by advertising jingles. You have thoughts that have been planted in your mind by the religion you've been exposed to. And the Gnostic myth teaches that the human species faces a test, that by seeing the presence of the archon thinking in our minds, which is delusional, we learn to claim the real power of our minds. They are here to test us. They are not here to conquer us, because we have more power than them. Several Gnostic passages say this very clearly. But they present a test for us to see through the deception and the hoax and the fraud that we ourselves can perpetrate on ourselves. When we see through that, then we can claim the real divine power of the human mind, which is the power of imagination. The power of imagination is really important in Gnostic teachings. They call it the luminous epinoia, E-P-I-N-O-I-A. And they say that the power of imagination was implanted in us so that we can see through the deceit of the archons and through our own deceit, through our own capacity for deceit. If we can see through our own capacity for deceit, we have nothing to fear from any extraterrestrial powers. Nothing.
And this one's about the archons and Castañeda. You state that archons intrude at the moment we humans fail to detect our own errors in habit and inflict their influence. Castañeda maintains that internal silence allows one a moment's pause to detect the error and self-correct, there maintaining our freedom. Were the Gnostics aware of this trick, and did the Gnostics attain the condition of internal silence?
They certainly did. And I attain that condition in the practice that I do, which is a type of visionary shamanism. I call it telestic shamanism, using that word telestai, meaning aimed. Today, for instance, I did a rite, a ritual of telestic shamanism, that is, shamanism with a particular purpose or intention. And when I do these rituals, I make a practice to do them in silent mind, empty mind. And in empty mind, we can see the true nature, the true enlightened nature of our own consciousness. And we immediately repel the delusional and deceptive tendencies that can arise. So, as I said before, if you claim your own ability for imagination and enlightenment and take responsibility for it, you're on the real path of the divine endowment of humanity, and there is nothing to fear. You know, there is no evil anywhere in the universe. Evil does not exist. There's no such thing as evil. The evil that you see on this planet right now is totally human-made, human-manufactured. There is no supernatural evil. There is no satanic evil anywhere in the universe, and we have nothing to fear. And all of the fear that is created toward that is generated out of our own stupidity. This is what Gnostics would teach you and tell you if they were here today.
And this last question from this person, Castañeda maintains human awareness is a cultivated food source for the archons, who hide in the shadows and provoke emotional outbursts. He once displayed a photograph of a flying archon, which materialized over a large congregation of Buddhists gathered at a Mexican pyramid. The archon was feeding on the emotional energy of the mass. Were the Gnostics aware of this human condition as chicken in a coop? Can the archons find an alternative food supply?
Yeah, well, the archons don't eat our food, don't eat our fear. They don't feed on our fear because they need that food to survive. They feed on our fear because they like that food as a junk food. You know, that's not. There's plenty of else they can survive on in their own world. It's not like they need to feed on our fears. The Apocryphon, or Secret Book of John, is a long cosmological text in Nag Hammadi. And it describes in explicit detail how they feed on fear and how they vampirize us in that way, exactly in the way that Castañeda describes. And I've met those flyers myself, by the way. I've encountered a good many of them. And Castañeda was really wonderful. I don't know where in the hell he ever got it from, but some of the information that he has is as if it were taken completely from the Gnostic materials there. I compare 16 different things in Castaneda with Gnostic teachings. And just about everything that Carlos says in that vein is consistent with the Gnostic teachings.
And can you explain what your spiritual practice, this is a multi-pronged question. Can you explain what your spiritual practice is? Do you have a daily spiritual practice, or what can you recommend to people to help to stay centered in these times?
Well, one of the most important things for a spiritual practice in the Gnostic or telestic sense is to have a sacred place where you can go. And sorry to say this, folks, but you're not going to be able to do it in a city. The sacred practices that will connect you with the goddess Sophia and eventually bring you to encounter the organic light must, I repeat, must be undergone in the country and out in nature. And so the first thing is to go out in nature, even if you don't live, if you have to live in a city, to go outside of the city and find some place in nature which is sacred to you, where you make the connection to the earth, and you'll know it because you feel it. In that place, you can practice your ritual. Second thing is, no, I don't practice it every day, and the word ritual might be a little misleading. I don't do ritual in some kind of sense of prayers or chanting, or it's not formal ritual. It's informal, novel, creative ritual. It changes all the time, but there are certain practices I do consistently, one of which is courtings. And you can read on Metahistory site, and there are some pictures of my courtings that I've done by myself and with other people. I just did a courting today. A courting is when you take strands of yarn and thread and you put them in the branches of a tree, ritually weave them into the branches of a tree to make sort of a mandala in the tree. And into that mandala, you introduce an intention. And when the mandala or the courting is complete, you release the intention, and it goes into the mind of Gaia, becomes part of the tree, becomes part of the atmosphere, and then your intention is married and interactive with her intention. And there are other rituals as well, but that's one of the ones that I do most frequently.
And in addition to you, what authors do you recommend in the Gnostic world, since you have stated there is a lot of confusing or inaccurate literature on this topic?
Yeah. There's only one other book that I would recommend that you read as a companion to Not in His Image, and that is the little book, thin little book called The Gnostics, written by a Frenchman named Jacques Lacarrière, L-E-C-A-R-R-I-E-R, The Gnostics. I have to tell you that Gnostic scholarship, I was born in 1945 in December, and I may have been born on the week or maybe even the day that these documents were discovered. And whatever that coincidence may mean, I can tell you that Gnostic scholarship is a scandal. It is absolutely outrageous. And I am really angry at Gnostic scholars like Elaine Pagels and Karen King, who have totally failed to deliver the pagan Sophianic aspect of Gnosticism to the world. They have really done a disservice to these materials. You know, Elaine Pagel's book, The Gnostic Gospels, does not even list archons in the index, in the index in back of the book. This is outrageous. I don't recommend any of these people. Don't bother to read them. If you want to get one of the most, or perhaps the most, liberating message for our species that comes from the ancient world, you can find it in Not in His Image, but you won't find it in these other scholars, because they do not reconstruct the Sophia story, and they completely disregard the supernatural element in Gnosticism.
And just a couple of questions left. This is an interesting one. Is there any correlation between the Archons and the Nazis?
Well, one point I want to make is that the Gnostic texts are very clear. I believe it's in the dialogue of the Savior. And by the way, a Savior in Gnostic terms is not like Jesus, the Savior or the Redeemer. A savior is someone who gives the knowledge that saves. A savior is someone who awakens you, points you to the knowledge in yourself that will save you. It is only the self-knowledge of your own divine gifts that will save you. No redeemer or no savior from outside can do that. So in the dialogue of the savior, points out that the archons are not evil. You can't call them evil and you can't blame them for human evil. Now, the Nazis were really evil, and the current day Nazis are even worse. You know, the Nazis we're facing today in this globalist mafia are 10 times worse than the German Nazis. But you know what? They're just human beings. There's nothing supernatural about them. They are not wizards from outer space. They are not directed by reptilians. They're just really corrupted, sick, psychopathic, murderous people, but they're just people. So no, I would not say that the archons are responsible for the mindset of the Nazis. Evil is our creation.
People like Jay Whitener say that our leaders report to the managers, i.e. meaning the Rothschilds, the Rockefellers, and the Rockefellers and Rothschilds report to somebody else. Is that the archons?
Well, you know, where are you going to take this hierarchy? Obviously, there is some kind of hierarchy. Obviously, the problem on this planet is this pyramidal hierarchy, like the pyramid you see on the American dollar.
Yes.
And as I said earlier, the source of all our problems is in this damn theocracy. Theocracy is a curse on humanity. And these people represent the end game of theocracy. Who do the Rothschilds report to? Who is at the top of the pyramid? Probably some insane figments in their own minds, you know? I mean, it's like living on this planet is like living in an insane asylum that's run by the most dangerous patients. I mean, how in the hell did we ever get to this place, you know? Well, we got to this place because we had a guiding vision of our divine connection to the planet that was destroyed and taken away from us. And I say, if we claim it back and build the magic of our lives in the framework of that vision, we can do anything we want in this planet.
And John, give us some concluding remarks for everybody around the world who's listening to you.
I think that since 9/11, there's been a tremendous awakening. And it's not necessarily a great mystical or spiritual awakening. It's just awakening to the fact that we are being screwed and lied to, and that the problems that are facing humanity are deliberately created problems. And that's why we can't solve them. I firmly believe that there is no evil in the cosmos, and I firmly believe that human beings could sort out their problems and create cooperative societies as long as their problems were not deliberately orchestrated. But that seems to be the case. So up against something really evil in human terms, and there's an evil genius in this power that's working against humanity. And my last word would be, let's not spend too much time investigating what that evil genius is doing to us. It's important to know because we don't want to be blind. But let's say spend 20% of our time investigating what the evil genius is doing to the rest of humanity. And then put most of our intention and most of our love into the counter magic. It's time to discover the counter magic. The magic that we're really born to manifest. And that magic is based in our connection with the divine Sophia. We can't do it alone. We can only do it with her, through her, for her. And the way to connect to her is through her story.
And I have to tell you, folks, you're going to have to listen to the show more than 2-3 times in order to absorb everything, and that's the way we love it. Once again, John Lamblash, how do we get in touch with your work? How do we immerse with all this great work?
Hey, it's really easy to get in touch with me, you know. And I also follow the principle that you find in the meditations of Marcus Aurelius. As I said, he was a great pagan philosopher, and he was also a Roman emperor, so you can imagine that he had a lot to do. But one of the things he says in the meditation is that it's never too busy to see somebody. So I'm never too busy to see someone or write to someone, respond. Just write to me on the website. Go to Metahistory, and you'll find JLL at metahistory.org. That's how you reach me.
And that's how we got in touch. And we also have links on our website where you can buy
all of
John's books. John Lamb Lash, it has been a pleasure and an honor. And like I said, this is just part one. I'd love to have you back in the near future so we can continue learning from your teachings.
I'm very grateful for the opportunity to present the Gnostic message, the story of the Telestai and those who are aimed. And I say this is a terrific beginning. And thank you very much for inviting me, Mel.
Great. Well, thank you so much, John. It's very late there in Andalusia. Love that area where you live in. Hopefully in the future I'll get to visit you.
That would be fantastic. I would love to see you. And so much beauty here and so much magic of the goddess. And we could just talk and laugh and really enjoy that. And it's been really great. And thank you so much for having me.
Thank you. You too. Have a pleasant night.
Bye-bye.
Bye. From the southernmost point of Europe in Andalusia, Spain, that was John Lamb Lash. As an eternal student, this was definitely another door opened in my quest for the truth. That door is only slightly open. That's why I'm delighted to know that John Lash will be back with us in the near future. A guest with decades of research and substance. And as I quoted at the beginning of the show, he says, "I have only this to tell you about my enlightenment. It's yours." Thank you, John. We look forward to much more. John's book, Not in His Image, is highly recommended as a foundation to Gnosticism. I admit, I'm at the elementary stages. That said, perhaps there are plenty of us who are always Gnostics and did not know or were prevented from discovering. Carl Sagan's quote, "I don't want to believe, I want to know," is epitomized in John Lash's work. No wonder I feel so related to it. I hope you continue to join me in the pursuit of gnosis, of knowledge, of the truth. And I want to thank you, Veritas member, for your loyalty and support. Without you, this show would not have been possible. And I'll leave you with a quote from John Lash. "The divine victim mirrors to humanity, not the solution to our suffering and a way to overcome it, but our total, consuming enslavement to it. Victimage works because it makes the force of suffering look stronger than the life force itself." Thanks for listening. I'm Mel Fabregas. Until next week, be well, and remember, be skeptical, but don't close your mind.